last night I spoke to a few hundred Christian pastors, and I'd like to report on one of the issues that was raised, and that is, do you vote for, they were all of a conservative bent, the traditional Christians, evangelical Christians specifically, and the issue arose, do you vote for a candidate who does not meet essentially all of your values? And one prominent pastor spoke and said that he had not voted for president. He had voted. One prominent pastor said, you have to vote. And let me make this clear, because I'm doing something I rarely do, which is I'm interrupting what I'm saying to bring you another point. But I need to give you context here. One pastor got up. I gave the keynote address, but there were other excellent addresses. And one of the pastors noted that it's got to be the task, the goal of evangelical Christians to get other evangelicals to vote. What was the percentage, they said, of evangelicals that don't vote? It was something like 40% or something. I need to do an hour on that with you next week, because a lot of evangelicals listen to this program. Does that sound right to those of you who are of that, in that movement of evangelical Christianity, that 40% don't vote? If it's anywhere, let me put it this way: if it is anywhere near the truth, then evangelical Christians bear some responsibility for the decline in the values of the society. The thrust was you got to get people to vote. And pastor after pastor said that. Then one pastor was very specific, great speaker, actually. And everything he said was fantastic. And then he said, and we can't compromise, though, on who we vote for. And he has not voted for a Republican. He doesn't vote for a Democrat for president, but he has not voted for Republican since Ronald Reagan. And I was thinking, because he spoke with conviction about the need to keep marriage defined male, female. And does he not understand that if Mitt Romney were president, we would not have a president who supports the redefinition of marriage? And yet he wouldn't vote for him because he didn't meet all the criteria that he would want Mitt Romney to have met? If that 40% figure is correct, you realize that would make the difference. If just half the evangelicals who don't vote did vote, it would turn around elections in the United States of America. And that's a pretty important statistic, if that's accurate. That is one important statistic. Let's go to Sean in Santa Clarita, California. Sean, Dennis Prager, hi.
This is Sean, your ex-felon seminarian grad from Santa Clarita.
How you doing?
Good. Just real quickly, I am plugged into the evangelical world up here pretty well in Santa Clarita, and I've got a friend a little bit older than myself, and he refused to vote for Meg Whitman in the 2010 governor's race because she wasn't pro-life enough. And one of the points I made with him was that she was for parental notification, whereas her opponent was not. And he said, I don't care, she's not pro-life. And so yep. I used your phrase, ruining the good with the perfect.
And obviously it didn't work. But there's a very good argument to be made. Just here's what you say. So let me ask you, let's say in case, as I said, in the presidential race, ask any evangelical if the country would be closer to his or her values if Mitt Romney were president than if Barack Obama were president. Right? Just think of the things that have been pushed through here with regard to forcing Catholic hospitals to give contraception forcing the same-sex marriage issue. As soon as President Obama changed his mind, quote-unquote, the floodgates opened. perfection is available in heaven. On earth, we want things to be better. I know of no biblical phrase that says, if it isn't perfect, don't try to improve things. I don't even know of such a suggestion. When God chose Moses to lead the Israelites out of Egypt, did he pick a perfect man? Is there any suggestion that he's perfect?